gives you illusion that has the appearance of truth, but I give you truth in the pleasant disguise of illusion. I take you back to an alley in St. Louis. The time, that quaint period when the huge middle class of America was matriculated from a school of life. Their eyes had failed, or they had failed their eyes. And so they were having their fingers pressed forcibly down on the cloudy rail tablet of dissolving time. In Spain, there was revolution. Here, there was only shouting and confusion and labor services, sometimes violent. In other words, peaceful cities such as Cleveland, Chicago, Detroit. That is the social background of this play. The play is memory. Being a memory play, it is dimly, it's sedimental. It is not realistic. In memory, everything seems to happen to music. That explains the fiddle of the things. I am an narrator of the play. I am also a character. Other characters in the play are my mother, Amanda, my sister, Laura, and the gentleman Colin, who appears in the final scenes. But he is the most realistic character in the play, being an emissary of a world which we were somehow set apart from. But having a poet's weakness for symbols, I use this character as a symbol, as a long-delayed but always expected something of him. There's a fifth character who doesn't appear except in this photograph hanging on the wall. When you look at the picture of this grinning gentleman, please remember that this is our father, who left us a long time ago. He was a telephone man who fell in love with long distances. And so he gave up his job at the telephone company and he skipped the life fantastic out of town. Last we heard of him was a picture postcard from the Pacific coast of Mexico. It contained a message of two words. Hello, goodbye, and no regrets.
I bet you can tell.
Well,
fiasco at Rubicam Business College. The idea of getting a gentleman caller for my sister Laura began to play a more and more important part in my mother's calculations. It became an obsession, like some archetype of the universal unconscious. This image of the gentleman caller haunted our small apartment. An evening at home rarely passed without some allusion to this image, this specter, this hope. And even when he wasn't mentioned, his presence hung in my mother's preoccupied look, and in my sister's frightened, apologetic manner. It felt like a sentence passed upon the wing fields. But my mother was a woman of action as well as words. Late that winter and in the early spring, realizing that money would be needed to properly feather the nest and put the bird, she began a vigorous campaign on the telephone, roping in subscribers to one of those magazines for matrons entitled The Homemaker's Companion. It was the type of journal which features the serialized sublimations of ladies of letters who think in terms of delicate cup-like breasts, slim, tapering waists, rich, creamy thighs, eyes like wood smoke and autumn, fingers that caress and soothe like soft, soft strains of music. Bodies as powerful as a trusted sculpture.
You'll go. since it's a point of water, it's back and forth between fishes, at first it turned to wine. Yeah, it turned to wine. And then it turned to beer, and then it turned to whiskey. Now, I know it was whiskey that I turned into, because, well, you know, maybe the assistant to come out and help me. And I think of both times, it was Kentucky straight road. He was a very generous fellow. He gave you super beer. He gave me this. This is his magic scarf. You can have it though. You see me waving over a canary gate? And you get a bowl of goldfish. You wave it over the goldfish bowl and they fly away in canaries. But the wonderfulest trick of all was the coffin trick. Look. Look at the mouth. Look.
makes me nervous.
I realize.
You know, I've had to put up a solitary battle all these years. But you're my right-hand valor. Don't fail me. Don't fall down.
I try.
That's all right. You just keep on trying. You're bound to succeed. You're full of natural endowments. Both my children are. And they're very precious children. Just promise me one thing.
What is it?
Promise me you won't become a drunkard.
I promise you. I won't ever become a drunkard.
That's what frightened me so. The easy drinking. Ain't a bowl of Purina.
No, Mother, just coffee.
Shredded wheat biscuits?
No, thanks. No, just coffee up front.
You can't put a full day's work on an empty stomach. You've got 10 minutes. Don't go. Drinking too hot liquid makes cancer in the stomach. Put cream in.
No, thanks.
To cool it?
No!
Do
all women find adventure in their careers?
They do it.
too late.
Down the warehouse. Arthur's not down yet?
No, no, no.
But there must be some.
Mother?
Find one that's a clean living, doesn't drink, and ask him out for sister.
What?
For sister, to me, to get acquainted with?
Oh, my God. Yes. Across the alley was the Paradise Dance Hall. Evenings in spring, they'd open up all the doors and windows, and the music would come outside. Sometimes they'd turn out all the lights, except for a large glass sphere that hung in the ceiling. That glass sphere would twirl slowly about, filter the dust with delicate rainbow colors. The orchestra would strike up a waltz or a tango, something that had a slow, sensuous rhythm. The young couples would come outside to the thud of privacy of the alley. You could see them kissing behind ash pits and telephone poles. That was the compensation for lives that passed like mine, without change or adventure. Change is an adventure of our own, weren't it this year? They were waiting around the corner for all those dancing kids. Suspended in the midst of a burnt discovery, caught in the folds of Chamberlain's umbrella. In Spain, there was vinegar. Here, there was only hot swing music and liquor, dance halls, bars, and movies, and sets that hung in the gloom like a shed of vinegar and filtered the dust with bright, bright rainbows. Well, these unsuspecting kids were dancing to Dear One, the World is Waiting for the Sunrise. All the world was really waiting. Came out on the terrace to smoke.
Thanks.
His name's O'Connor.
O'Connor? He's Irish and tomorrow's Friday? That means fish. I know. I'm in Sandwell with my nanny's dressing on. Where'd you meet him?
At the warehouse, of course. Where else would I meet him?
Oh, I don't know. Does he drink?
Now, what made you ask me that?
Because your father did.
Oh, don't get started on that.
He drinks then?
No, not that I know.
We have to find out. There's nothing I want.
Mother, aren't you just being a little bit premature? After all, poor Mr. O'Connor hasn't even appeared on the scene yet.
But he will tomorrow, to meet sister. And what do I know about this character?
What are you doing?
I always did hate that coward. I can never understand why he could sit down by himself.
Mother, I want to tell you something, and I mean it sincerely, right straight from my heart. There's a lot of boys who meet girls who they don't marry.
You know, you always had me worried that you could never stick to a subject. Now what I want to know is, what's his position at the warehouse?
He's a shipping clerk.
Oh, a shipping clerk. Well, that's very important. That's what you think you had more to get up. Now, what I want to know is, what is he earning?
Well, I have no way of knowing that for sure. I judge his salary to be approximately $85 a month.
$85? Well, that's not intrinsic.
It's $20 more than I make.
Oh, I know that. How well I know that. How well I know that. $85 more. No, it can't be done. A family man can never get by $85 a month.
Mother, Mr. O'Connor is not a family man.
But he might be. Might be.
Oh, I see. Plans and provisions.
You know, you're the only man I know of that doesn't realize that the present, the past, and the past is an everlasting regret if you don't plan for it.
I'll think that over and see what I can make of it.
Don't be supercilious with your mother. Now tell me more about this. What did you call him? Mr. O'Connor. Mr. O'Connor. He must have some other name besides Mr.
His full name is James D. O'Connor. The D is for the lady.
The lady? Irish on both sides and gets a drink?
You want me to call him up and ask him?
No.
No, I'll call him up and tell him. You want to know if he drinks.
No, you must do that. We have to be discreet about this stuff. When I was a girl, good about it, and he suspected that a man was drinking, and any girl was receiving his attention, then she could have been to the church and asked about his character. Or her father, if he was alive, it was his duty to go to the church and ask about his character. That's how young girls have been around.
How come you made such a tragic one?
I don't know how he did it. That face fooled everybody. All he had to do was grin, the whole world was bewitched. Oh, I think it's tragic the young girl put herself at the mercy of a young, handsome parent. Well, I hope Mr. O'Connor isn't too good looking.
No, he's not too good looking. Well, his face is covered with freckles, and he has a really large nose.
He's not right now. Homely, is he?
Well, not right down homely. Medium homely, I'd say.
Well, if a girl had any sense, she must have cared for that anyhow.
Yeah, well, that's what I always said.
You've always said it. How could you have always said it if you've never even thought about it?
Well, don't be so suspicious of me.
I am. I'm suspicious of every word that comes out of your mouth when you talk to me. But what if... Is he up and coming?
Yeah, you know, I really do think he goes in for self-improvement.
What makes you think that?
Well, he goes to night school.
Well, what does he do there at night school?
Well, he's studying radio engineering and public speaking.
Well, public speaking, that shows he intends to be an executive someday. And radio engineering? Well, that's up and coming, isn't it?
I bet it's you.
Well, those are very limited facts. Facts that any mother should know about. A man coming to call on her daughter, seriously or not.
Just one little warning. I didn't tell Jim about the ball. I didn't let on that we had dark, ulterior motives. I just said, how about coming over for dinner sometime? And he said, fine, and that was the whole conversation.
I bet it was, too. Sometimes you can be as eloquent as an oyster. But when he sees how sweet and pretty Laura is, well, he's going to be mighty glad he asked over to have some supper.
Mother, just one little thing. You won't expect.
all those things to you and me because she's ours, and we love her. We don't even notice she's crippled anymore.
Don't say that word.
Well, you have to face the facts. She is. And that's not all.
What do you mean, that's not all?
Well, Mother, you know that Laura is very different from other girls.
Yes, I know that, and I think that did us all no favor.
Not quite all. You see, in the eyes of others, strangers, she's terribly shy. She lives in a world of her own, and those things make her seem a little peculiar to people outside the house.
Don't use that word, peculiar.
You have to face the facts. She is.
I don't see in what way she's peculiar.
Mother, Laura lives in a world of little glass animals. She plays all